Catholics must view Mary as a god and worship her. Brainwashed to believe this stuff. Christians in the ancient world writing that Mary was sinless. And through the power of his death on the cross, retroactively, that saved her. Nor any stains upon your mother. Free of any stain of sin. Was exempt from putridity and corruption. All of the Marian dogmas do nothing more than uplift Jesus and establish his divinity. Hey guys, it's Lizzie. Today I'm going to talk about the Immaculate Conception dogma in Catholicism and prove that Mary was sinless, free of all personal sin. A lot of people wrongly believe that the Immaculate Conception is the angel Gabriel asking Mary to be the mother of God and her saying yes. But that is the Annunciation. The Immaculate Conception has to do with Mary as a baby and her graces of being born free of original sin and living sinless throughout her life. At her conception, God gave Mary more grace, and through the power of his death on the cross, she was conceived and born without original sin and undid the curses of the garden by living free of all sin. It is through the power of God and Mary cooperating with his grace because he is her savior. Understanding this theology helps us to uplift and be even more in awe of God. To deeply worship Jesus as King. The early Christians called Mary the Ark of the Covenant, which in the Old Testament contained the Ten Commandments and was placed in the Holy of Holies. It was covered with gold, veiled, and if you touched it, you died. And so it is fitting that Jesus, as the Word of God and as God, had a pure, immaculate, perfect womb to dwell in and a perfect, immaculate mother in the Virgin Mary to love and take care of him. If you're new to my channel, I am a Catholic convert. I grew up Protestant my entire life and came into the Catholic Church in 2018. The Marian theologies were some of the hardest dogmas for me to accept, and I even thought at one point that all Catholics were brainwashed to believe this stuff. Mary being sinless sounded crazy and impossible and diametrically opposed to Christianity. But I came to believe in this because the early Christians taught it and because I trust in the teaching magisterium. And I want to repeat what the angel Gabriel says to Mary in Luke 1:37. For nothing will be impossible with God. This is the 100th video I've made on Catholic theology and apologetics, so I will link below the playlist to all of those other videos. Also, I have an entire playlist just on my Mary theology videos. I've talked about the perpetual virginity of Mary, the Assumption of Mary, praying the Rosary, and why we call Mary Queen of Heaven. So all of those videos will be linked below. We have a lot to discuss in this video, so please commit to watching it all the way through. We're going to start by addressing the three most common lies that Protestants believe about the Immaculate Conception: Mary as the Ark of the Covenant, Mary being the new Eve, early Christian writings about the sinlessness of Mary, and the teaching magisterium and when this was defined as a Catholic dogma. A lot of this has to do with Old Testament realities that are intrinsically linked to Jesus' mission on earth. In Matthew 5:17, Jesus makes it very clear. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. So these are the three lies Protestants believe about the Immaculate Conception. Number one, Mary being sinless means she didn't need a savior. Number two, it makes Mary into a god. Number three, the reason Catholics made this up is because they believe in original sin, and in their formula, otherwise, Mary's original sin would have been passed on to Jesus. And bonus, Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, completely refutes this theology. Before we explore each of these misconceptions, this video is sponsored by my favorite Catholic company, Christian Catholic Shop, and I mean this. They've sponsored my videos before. I wear their t-shirts in my videos and live streams. You've seen their rosaries in my rosary videos. So they basically make t-shirts, rosaries, jewelry, and miraculous medals. Today they want me to talk about their rosary of the month, and I'm actually wearing the bracelet that is part of it. It also comes with a prayer card, and then the rosary. It has roses surrounding the crucifix. It's so pretty. And then it has these pink marble beads, and then in between each decade, they have a rose, which is the little flower, is the name of Saint Teresa de Lisieux. So it's really cool. They have these themed rosary of the month. It's just $20 every month, and you get a saint bracelet with a medal on it, a rosary, and a prayer card, and they're themed every month. So I'm gonna link below all the information for Rosary of the Month, and we're doing a giveaway on my Instagram of the Saint Teresa de Lisieux Rosary of the Month bundle. So go follow my Instagram and I will pick a winner. So now let's get back into the video. The three misconceptions about the Immaculate Conception, and then we'll go into early Christian writings talking about it. Number one, the Immaculate Conception takes away God's power, and Mary being sinless means she doesn't need a savior. No, it's the exact opposite. She needed even more of God's power to never sin and to be born without original sin. The power of Jesus' death, dying on the cross, retroactively, that power is what saved Mary. In Catholicism, we view works, righteous actions, as always being intertwined with God's grace. So every time that Mary chose to not sin and to live perfect, she was cooperating with God's grace. It was His grace working through her. Number two. Only God can be sinless. Therefore, Catholics must view Mary as a god and worship her. No. Living sinless is not unique to God. Adam and Eve were also immaculately conceived, born without original sin, and lived a lot of their life without sinning. In addition, every angel has free will, billions of angelic beings, and two-thirds of them who remained in heaven, the other third fought God, left heaven with Satan, but two-thirds, billions of those angels, were born without original sin and constantly live free of sin. Also, in heaven right now, there are millions of Christians whose souls are surrounding God's throne, and they are living sinless. These Christians are perfect and pure and immaculate, but they are not God. So these are many exceptions of other sentient beings who are choosing to constantly live without sin and cooperate with God's grace. Number three, Mary had to be born without original sin, or her original sin would pass on to her child, Jesus. This is obviously wrong, because if Mary could be conceived without original sin, without Anna and Jehoiakim, her parents, passing on their original sin to her, then obviously God could have made it happen where Mary's original sin didn't pass on to Jesus. This is the Protestant problem of ascribing so little to Mary, assuming that she was merely used as a woman to give birth to a man. Bonus number four, Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." It doesn't give a caveat for Mary. So what about this Bible verse? And what about Mary's reaction to finding Jesus at the temple? What about Matthew 12:46-50? What about Simeon's sword? Did Mary experience doubt at the foot of the cross? I have a simple response to that. Sola Scriptura has created thousands of Protestant churches who all disagree with each other on how to interpret the Bible. Your intuitions on these verses are shaped by how you grew up, and the church down the street disagrees with you. As Catholics, we also believe we go by the Bible, but the early Christians and modern Catholics do not view these verses as contradicting the Immaculate Conception. I think the most obvious read of Romans 3:23 is that, of course, Mary is sinless. You don't even have to mention it. Everyone knows it. I want to give the perfect example of this. In the 4th century, Saint Augustine was writing Punishment and Forgiveness of Sins. He says in the book, "There are no exceptions. Everyone has sinned." This was written in the year 411. Then in 415, in Nature and Grace, he offers the exception that everyone but Mary has sinned. Did he change his mind in those 4 years? No! He was a Catholic bishop. He agreed with all church teaching in 411 and 415. It's just everyone knew Mary was sinless, and so you didn't even need to always mention it. I could make an entire video sharing Bible verses that I read in one way my entire life that seemed so obvious. But then when I became Catholic, I learned that the Catholic Church interpreted the same Bible verses in the opposite way. And it's the same between different Protestant churches as well. I made an entire video, 10 reasons why Sola Scriptura is wrong. So I will link that video below. In 2 Thessalonians 2:15, St. Paul says, "To stand firm and hold fast to the traditions that were passed down to us, either by spoken word or by letter." So going by the Bible also means going by the oral teachings of the church that have been passed down to the current day. Which, the oral teachings starting in the first century, that apostolic oral tradition currently says the Immaculate Conception is true and Mary is sinless. I mentioned this in the intro of the video, how Catholics think of Mary as the Ark of the Covenant. She's also talked about as the burning bush, how she contained the fire of God but was not consumed. So, refresher on the Ark of the Covenant. In Exodus 20, Moses is given the Ten Commandments by God. 5 chapters later, from Exodus 25 to Exodus 30, Moses describes in depth how the Ark of the Covenant will be constructed, and it is to hold the Ten Commandments. Exodus 25:11-12. "You shall overlay it with pure gold. Inside and outside you shall overlay it. And you shall make a molding of gold upon it all around. You shall cast 4 rings of gold for it, and put them on its 4 feet, 2 rings on the one side of it, and 2 rings on the other side." And it goes on and on describing how beautiful and intricate it is to be constructed. Within the Ark of the Covenant, it not only contains the Ten Commandments, but also Aaron's staff symbolizing the priesthood, and a golden jar of manna, which Christians interpreted as typology to how Jesus is the high priest and also the bread of life most revealed in the Eucharist. We're going to make some connections between the Old Testament and the New Testament, but first I want to read some quotes of early Christians talking about Mary as the Ark of the Covenant. So the first Christian is named Gregory the Wonderworker. He was born in the year 213 and died in the year 270. He wrote, "Let us chant the melody that has been taught us by the inspired harp of David, and say, Arise, O Lord, into thy rest, thou and the ark of thy sanctuary. For the Holy Virgin is in truth an ark, wrought with gold both within and without, that has received the whole treasury of the sanctuary." Next is Athanasius of Alexandria. He was born in the year 296 and died in 373. "O noble Virgin, Truly, you are greater than any other greatness. For who is your equal in greatness, O dwelling place of God the Word? To whom among all creatures shall I compare you, O Virgin? You are greater than them all, O Ark of the Covenant, clothed with purity instead of gold. You are the ark in which is found the golden vessel containing the true manna, that is, the flesh in which divinity resides. The Ark of the Covenant is carried by the Israelites all the way through the wilderness, set up in the temple tent called the Tabernacle, and then finally set up in the Holy of Holies room once they get to the Promised Land and build the temple. The Holy of Holies is where God's full presence resided, and no one was allowed in. The high priest would only go in once a year to offer a sacrifice, and a piece of rope was attached to the priest's leg to pull him out in case he died while in front of God. This is how much they uplifted and worshiped and how highly they viewed God. I think for a lot of us, we've lost that complete awe and reverence. So thinking of Jesus being that Word of God and that Bread of Life dwelling in the Holy of Holies, being fully God coming down to earth, it only makes sense that his Ark of the Covenant in the Virgin Mary's womb would be just as beautiful and intricate, pure gold and perfection to hold the King of Kings. I hope you're realizing that all of the Marian dogmas do nothing more than uplift Jesus and establish his divinity. Now, here are some really cool scriptural parallels we see between the Old Testament and the Ark of the Covenant and the New Testament and the Virgin Mary. So starting off in Exodus 40, 33 to 35, it's talking about the Ark of the Covenant being set up in the tabernacle, which is the traveling temple, which is a tent that they used in the wilderness. He set up a court around the tabernacle and the altar and put up the screen at the gate of the court. So Moses finished the work. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses was not able to enter the tent of meeting because the cloud settled upon it. And the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Then going forward to Luke 1:35, during the Annunciation, the angel Gabriel says to Mary, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God." Another example is in 2 Samuel 6:9, King David is presented with the Ark of the Covenant. David was afraid of the Lord that day. He said, "How can the Ark of the Lord come into my care?" In the same way, when Mary visits her cousin Elizabeth in Luke 1:43, Elizabeth has the same reaction. "And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my Lord comes to me?" Then going back to the passage in 2 Samuel, David dances in front of the Ark of the Covenant with joy. David danced before the Lord with all his might. David was girded with a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the Ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. And then in Luke 1:44, just as David danced and leapt for joy before the Ark of the Covenant, John the Baptist in Elizabeth's womb leaps for joy upon meeting and being in front of Mary, the new Ark of the Covenant. Both David and Elizabeth question their worthiness at meeting the Ark of the Covenant, but then rejoice. A final passage about the Ark of the Covenant is talked about in Revelation 11:19, "Then God's temple in heaven was opened, and the Ark of his covenant was seen within his temple. And there were flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, an earthquake, and heavy hail." And immediately after that, in Revelation 12, It talks about a great portent appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a crown of 12 stars. So I hope you guys are understanding and connecting the dots that Jesus as God is so holy and majestic and perfect, and so it doesn't make sense for him to come down on earth and dwell in someone who is not perfect and immaculate. It only makes sense that upon coming to earth, Jesus would be conceived and live as an unborn baby inside someone who is unstained by original sin, unstained by personal sin, gold in her virtue. Something really cool too is that the Son in heaven, the Son part of the Trinity, chose Mary to be his mother at the beginning of time. At the beginning of creation, he thought of her, and through the power of his death on the cross, forgiving all sins retroactively, that saved her from original sin and from personal sin. To make sense of it, Mary was about 12 years old when she was pregnant with Jesus, before the age of reason. And by this I mean that Jesus first spoke at the temple when he was 12 years old. And when the Israelites were exiled into the wilderness, punished, anyone under 16 was able to enter the promised land because they were not held morally culpable. So Mary was a child, and then she was constantly around God in the flesh. And I think of it like this: there are millions of souls in heaven right now surrounding God's throne in the pure presence of God inside the Holy of Holies, and they're choosing not to sin. And I experience it in my own life too. The closer I am to God, the more I'm putting into that relationship, the less I sin. And so it makes sense that through the power of God, through Jesus' death on the cross, he could make Mary immaculate. The new Eve. This is a concept not talked about in the majority of Protestant churches, and it was brand new and bizarre to me when I was converting into Catholicism. But along with the Ark of the Covenant, it's one of the most important things to understand in making sense of the Immaculate Conception and Mary being sinless. The earliest Christians called Mary the New Eve, and we're going to read some quotations from Justin Martyr, Irenaeus, Tertullian, and Ephrem the Syrian. They talk about how Mary was part of our salvation, and that in her saying yes to God, she helped to undo the curses of the garden. We get this from Revelation 12:17. It's talking about Mary. Then the dragon was angry with the woman and went off to make war on the rest of her children, those who keep the commandments of God and hold the testimony of Jesus. In Genesis 3:20, it refers to Eve as the mother of all the living. And so in the New Testament, in the New Covenant, Mary is the mother of all Christians. We also get this from John 19:27 when Jesus on the cross says, "Behold thy mother." In my 5 Reasons Mary Was a Perpetual Virgin video, we talked about how Jesus giving away his mother on the cross proves that he was an only sibling. Throughout the gospel, John refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved, and it's also this motif where we are aiming to be a disciple whom Jesus loved. And so it's not just talking about Jesus giving away his mom to John, but also giving Mary to all of us to be our Christian mother. Just as Christ is called the new Adam, Mary is the new Eve. I want to show you this church art I love so much. It describes the new Eve. In this picture, notice how Mary's foot is crushing the serpent from the Garden of Eden. By saying yes to Gabriel, to having Jesus, and cooperating with God's grace, Mary becomes part of our salvation. Here are 5 parts of Mary's role as the new Eve in undoing those curses. Number 1, she was born free of original sin, just like Eve. For every other Christian, we have to get baptized to remove those stains of original sin. For Mary, it never had to be erased or undone, she just never had it. Unlike Eve, she stayed free of all personal sin. Number 3, she didn't experience that fleshy type of temptation called concupiscence that has to do with lusting and our obsession with sex. All of her appetites and desires were rational. Number four, she had a painless childbirth, which is one of the curses in Genesis 3:16. I will greatly increase your pains in childbearing. In pain you shall bring forth children. So she had no birth pains at all, and I'm actually going to make a whole video about this because there's that verse in Revelation which people bring up to refute this theology, so look out for that video. Number five, she didn't experience the pains of death. As I talked about in my 5 Reasons I Believe in the Assumption of Mary video, she had a peaceful end to her life, and her body was immediately assumed up into heaven like Enoch and Elijah. It did not decay. As Catholics, we can believe that either Mary died peacefully or that she never died. I personally believe that she never died, but up to you. She's the prototype of all future Christians because she's fully embodied in heaven, just like how everyone else will be after the final judgment and resurrection. And she's just a model for us because on earth she lived sinless in the same way that we will hopefully someday in heaven. To prove that the New Eve theology is original to the ancient church, we're going to start by reading 3 of the earliest Christian writings about Mary and just earliest Christian writings in general from Justin Martyr, Tertullian, and Irenaeus. What's so important about each of these people is they lived on opposite sides of the Christian world. Justin Martyr lived in Rome, Tertullian in North Africa, and Irenaeus in modern-day Syria. So it shows that this was the universal theology of early Christianity. Irenaeus was taught by Polycarp, who was taught by the Apostle John. So we can trust that this is original to the apostles. Saint Justin Martyr was born in the year 100 and died in 155. This is in his dialogue with Trypho. For Eve, who was a virgin and undefiled, having conceived the word of the serpent, brought forth disobedience and death. But the Virgin Mary received faith and joy when the angel Gabriel announced the glad tidings to her that the Spirit of the Lord would come upon her and the power of the Highest would overshadow her. Now we're going to read from Saint Irenaeus of Lyon in his Against Heresies. Irenaeus was born in the year 130 and died in the year 200. This is being written in 185. In accordance with this design, Mary the Virgin is found obedient, saying, "Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to your word." But Eve was disobedient, for she did not obey when as yet she was a virgin. Having become disobedient, was made the cause of death, both to herself and to the entire human race. So also did Mary, having a man betrothed to her and being nevertheless a virgin, by yielding obedience became the cause of salvation, both to herself and to the whole human race. So next is from Tertullian. He was born in the year 155 and died in 220. This is from his work, The Flesh of Christ. For it was while Eve was yet a virgin that the ensnaring word had crept into her ear, which was to build the edifice of death. Into a virgin soul, in like manner, must be introduced that word of God, which was to raise the fabric of life, so that what had been reduced to ruin by this sex might by the selfsame sex be recovered to salvation. As Eve had believed the serpent, so Mary believed the angel. So next, I want to read a poem by Ephraim the Syrian. He was born in the year 306 and died in 373, so this is a little bit later, and this is from his Hymns on the Church. Behold the world. To it were given 2 eyes. Eve was the left eye, the blind eye. The right eye, the luminous eye, is Mary. Because of the eye that grew dark, the whole world became dark. Then men, groping in the shadows, will consider every stone on which they stumble to be a god. So now we're going to read some quotations of Christians in the ancient world actually writing that Mary was sinless. I want to start by saying that lack of written evidence does not mean the belief did not exist. Just because a belief was not explicitly written out in the first century doesn't mean they didn't believe it then. We're dealing with an oral culture, and not only has so much been lost since this was centuries and centuries ago, I'm sure there are so many writings that we're talking about this that we don't have access to anymore, but also they only wrote things down mostly if they were trying to refute a heresy. It was rare at this time for them to just write out their theology. And that is why as Catholics, we go by the oral tradition that was gradually written down by the church, because we're dealing with an oral culture. So we go by both the written scripture and the oral teachings that are written down through the years. That being said, we have Christians in the universal church in the 3rd century musing about the Immaculate Conception and writing about how Mary is sinless. Saint Hippolytus, who was born in the year 170 AD and died in 235, this is a quote from his writing, "Our Lord is my shepherd." So this was written in the early 3rd century. "He was the ark, formed of incorruptible wood. For by this is signified that his tabernacle was exempt from putridity and corruption." Then Saint Ephrem the Syrian, in his Nisbean hymns, he was born in the year 306 and died in 370. "You alone and your mother are more beautiful than any others, for there is no blemish in you nor any stains upon your mother. Who of my children can compare in beauty to these?" Also writing in the 4th century is Saint Ambrose of Milan. He was born in the year 339 and died in 397. In what is called Sermon 22, he writes, "Mary, a virgin, not only undefiled, but a virgin whom grace has made inviolate, free of any stain of sin." Then in Concerning Virginity, Book 2, he beautifully muses about the virtues of Mary's life and her moral perfection. We don't have time to read all of it, so I've linked it below along with everything else. I really encourage you to go click on the link and just read through his sermon. It's really, really beautiful. I picked this part that I want to read for you guys. "What is greater than the Mother of God? What more glorious than she whom glory itself chose? What more chaste than she who bore a body without contact with another body? For why should I speak of her other virtues? She was a virgin, not only in body, but also in mind, who stained the sincerity of its disposition by no guile, who was humble in heart, grave in speech, prudent in mind, sparing of words, studious in reading, resting her hope not on uncertain riches, but on the prayer of the poor, intent on work, modest in discourse, want to seek not man but God as the judge of her thoughts." Then a final quote by Ambrose's mentee, Saint Augustine of Hippo. He was born in the year 354 and died in 450. This is being written in 415. "We must exempt the Holy Virgin Mary, concerning whom I wish to raise no question when it touches the subject of sins, out of honor to the Lord, for from him we know what abundance of grace for overcoming sin in every particular was conferred upon her who had the merits to conceive and bear him who undoubtedly had no sin. Well then, if with this exception of the Virgin, we could only assemble together all the forementioned holy men and women, and ask them whether they lived without sin while they were in this life, what can we suppose would be their answer?" So I want to address the elephant in the room, which is that this was not made into a Catholic dogma until 1854. Pope Pius IX made it a dogma. You can go read it. It's called Ineffable God. I've linked it below. I talked about this so in depth in my Assumption of Mary video, that the year something is made a dogma is not the year that it originated. I hope I showed throughout the video that this wasn't created in 1854. It goes all the way back to the Old Testament and the New Testament, to the early Christians writing about Mary as the Ark of the Covenant and the New Eve, and as being pure of sin and immaculate. I have linked below where you can get this St. Teresa de Lisieux bracelet and the rosary that comes with it and the prayer card and how to sign up for Rosary of the Month. I've also linked below my videos. I prayed the rosary every day for a month and filmed the whole process, and I also have a video on how to pray the rosary for beginners, why pray the rosary. So probably a lot of you here are looking into Catholicism and thinking of becoming Catholic, and I'm so happy that you came across this video, just because the Marian dogmas are so hard to accept, and I really encourage you to dive into Mariology, understand it all the way, and develop a beautiful relationship with Mary through praying the rosary. I know I should probably make an entire video on veneration of the saints and the fellowship of the saints and all of that, but I really encourage you to dive in, to be courageous, to not be afraid, and to watch all the other videos in my Mary playlist. Also linked below is my Instagram and the post about how to win the Rosary of a Month. I'm also gonna write you guys a handwritten letter. I love you guys so much, and I will see you in my next video. Bye!